Next, we have Siegfried Hacker. If I can just pick one thing to say about you, I'll say professor of management science and engineering at Stanford. I could go on and on, but I just want to hear you talk now.
So I'm in favor of ratification of the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty. 20 years ago, since we're looking at 20 years back, 20 years ago, I was director of Los Alamos National Laboratory, and I was in the middle of this debate. And basically what I was asked, you know, by the president and the Pentagon is, can we deal with the risks of stopping nuclear testing? In other words, the risks that it might have on the stockpile of the United States. And at the time, my job was to deal with those risks and give the technical answer. And I said, at this point, our stockpile, that is the nuclear arsenal, is safe, secure, and reliable. However, you need to ask that question in coming years. And indeed, the presidents have asked that question every year since. So President Clinton clearly believed in 1996 that the comprehensive test ban was in the security interest of the United States. However, it's not ratified yet today, and so clearly some people don't believe it's in the interest of the United States. Let me give you first why I feel it's in the interest, and in essence, Rose Gottemiller has already made the main points. Testing is important to the United States. You lose something when you don't test. However, we gain more today when others don't test than what we lose. And particularly as you look down, let me just recite briefly how many nuclear tests have been conducted. United States, 1,054. Some of those were done with the UK. Russia, 715. France, 210. Britain, 45. China, 45. Pakistan, 6. India, 6. North Korea, 4. To those countries, as Rose Gottemiller points out, from North Korea up to Pakistan, to India, to China, an additional test or so will allow them to increase the sophistication or perhaps the diversification of their arsenals. And that can only come back to be a national security risk for the United States. So today, we have an enormous benefit by the test ban, and I believe we should do everything we can to have the barriers as high as possible for other countries resuming or beginning testing. And you only have to study the North Korea example to see how alarming nuclear testing is. Everything changed for North Korea in 2006. But now one has to ask the question today, so how come Americans aren't all in favor of this? Why are we not able to ratify the test ban today? And of course, part of that is political. You know, just the Washington scene of sort of at this point, maybe anything but Obama. However, we must also pay attention to the fact that there are quite a few people who have a lot of experience in the national security arena who do not favor the ratification of the comprehensive test ban. And the particular concern is, can we assure the safety, security, reliability of the nuclear arsenal without nuclear testing, particularly of an aging nuclear arsenal? The proponents of the test ban point out that, look, we've had science-based stockpile stewardship. It's been enormously successful. You can do it all with computers today. You don't need nuclear testing. You lose nothing by nuclear testing. The opponents say that's not true. We're concerned about safety, security, and reliability. And I believe we need to listen to both of those sides. There's no question that you do lose some confidence when you don't test. But when I testified in 1996, the essence was, look, we'll have to do everything we possibly can to assure the safety, security, and reliability without nuclear testing. And that, as Rose Gottemiller has pointed out, was called science-based stockpile stewardship. As we look back now over all of these years, indeed, we understand the fundamentals of things nuclear and how nuclear weapons work better today than we did in 1996. 1996. However, there are problems in the US nuclear weapons complex that actually most people just are not aware of. It takes more than just science-based stockpile stewardship to make sure that the nuclear arsenal is indeed safe, secure, and reliable. The entire nuclear complex and what's happened over these 20 years, and I've been inside that complex because I spent 34 years at Los Alamos, I have concerns about the viability of that complex. I have concerned about the fact that it is so difficult today in our regulatory environment, compliance-based environment, to actually do those laboratory tests that would allow me to assure that when plutonium ages or the high explosive ages, that we can still take care of the safety, security, and reliability. And so I'm here to tell you, look, I have some sympathy for those people who have concerns. However, the issue is that what needs to be done, in my opinion, is actually not nuclear testing. It's not necessarily nuclear testing that we're missing. It's the ability to go and do all of the other things in the laboratory, to bring the experiments together with the computational capabilities to be able to make the appropriate assurances. So in terms of suggestions then, of my suggestion of going forward would be that let's look at what the proponents and the opponents both have in common. What's the common ground? I think the common ground is both of them believe, if I've repeated it many times already, safe, secure, and reliable arsenal. In other words, that the US continues to have the deterrent both for its own purpose and for its allies. I think we both believe that that is actually important. And so if we could focus on that piece, then we understand that the testing is only one piece. Testing does not, you know, by itself assure that, and as I indicated, it actually isn't the most important thing to do today. So perhaps if one could agree on the fact that it is the stockpile that's important, that we can do those things, that we need to make sure that the complex actually has the ability to be able to perform the whole range of laboratory experiments, computation, and so forth, so that we could take care of the arsenal. Perhaps then we could actually convince the opponents of the test ban that it is indeed doable, and that ratification then going back to the fact that today, if these other countries do not test, it is to the great benefit of the United States. And so my own view would be that would be an appropriate direction to go if one wants to take up, as one should, the ratification of the test ban. I guess the other thing that I could say, most of my emphasis was on testing more so than ratification, but ratification is sort of a no-brainer once you already don't test. Because in other words, since we don't test, we already sort of suffer from the risks of not testing, but we don't get the benefits of fully locking in the fact that now we have a ratified international treaty, and that's what I believe should be done.